Last week, the title of the message was Fueling the Fire on the Altar of Our Heart. And we talked about Matthew chapter 3. And when John the Baptist said, I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I'm not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. So today, I'm going to talk about Christ came as a purging fire. So this would be part two. And many of the verses we'll be looking at are in the same chapter, in Luke chapter 12. So let's just read it out loud together from Luke 12, verse 49, and then I'll pray, and then you can sit back down. Ready? Luke 12, 49. I have come to bring fire on the earth, and how I wish it were already kindled. So, Lord, we say that we are opening our hearts to hear what you want to say to us today, that your word is nutrition to us, that your spirit and truth combine inside of our living bodies, and you give revelation off of the truth of your word. We thank you for the nourishment of your word and the power of your spirit to bring light and revelation on it. So we say we want to leave here changed by the power of your presence in our lives, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all for being obedient and patient. You know that I like the voice translation because I quote it a lot. And it's more of an expanded version than the New King James, or this happened to be the New English translation that I quoted. But he unpacks it a little bit deeper in the voice translation, and that's going to matter as we talk about this today. And I guess one little caveat I want to say is when Jesus said, I came to bring fire on the earth, some people, if we had a vote, would think that means judgment and anger. Anybody think that's true? Yeah, so that's understandable, depending on how you were raised and, you know, all of that background that we might have. But I don't think it's that. I think it's more the purifying and the refining fire that he was talking about. So that's the lens I'm going to be looking through today, that we've been talking about for 2 weeks now. Last week we talked about it as well. Oh, and I forgot my little altar. I forgot to put it out. But if you remember last week, we said that the analogy that Jesus was described as taking his winnowing fan in his hand and separating the wheat from the chaff. And the point was that we have chaff in our lives and we have wheat in our lives. And if we separate the chaff out, those things that God doesn't want us to have, we take the chaff and we put it in this fire, which is the altar of our heart. So the fire of our heart gets fueled by the things that we get rid of because God never wanted us to have them in the first place. And that's the reason I said Cindy's had 9 million meetings, I wasn't kidding. Because there's always going to be things that people have another layer that they can get down into. We think we've dealt with it all, and we have dealt with a lot, but God loves us so much that he wants us to go even deeper. And after you've seen him change your life and you get free from something, you want to go deeper. It's not fight or flight. It's like, no, I'm digging in. And one of the people that I recommended to come for counseling said, it's excruciating excavation. And it's not really funny if you knew her story, but if you saw the outcome of somebody who really went after it, it was amazing because she was ready to tackle it. And she was sick and tired of being sick and tired. And that's also part of this fire message, right? I'll say it now, Jeremiah 20, verse 9. His word was in my heart like a burning fire, shut up in my bones. I was weary of holding it back. It was in there, and he was trying to hold it back, and I couldn't hold it anymore, and he had to let it out. So if we could think about last week, it was more personal. As the Lord is revealing things to us that need to go, it can actually be a positive thing that we're fueling the fire on the altar of our heart with the chaff that needs to go. But now, it's more like there's a fire that gets placed inside of us because Jesus baptized us with the Holy Spirit and fire. Let it out. It's not easy. Because most of us are taught to be very non-confrontational. You want to be polite. You don't want to insult people. And to tell people that their worldview doesn't line up with the Bible, they don't like it. But if you love them, you'll tell them. You'll speak the truth in love. As soon as we stop speaking the truth in love, the world gets darker. And coward and Christian, not equal. Whatever that little symbol is, not equal. There's nothing about taking a stand for the Lord that's cowardly. It takes a lot of courage, doesn't it? But, you know, we can just get shut down. And I'm not blaming anybody because I understand that. I'm here to try to encourage you to let it out. You got fire inside of you. Let it out. Talk to people. You're not judging them. You're not berating them. You're not lecturing them. You're letting the love of God pour through you. And as that fire comes out, it starts to purge things off of their lives. It's good news. You're not calling out their problems. You're telling them there's an answer. They don't want you to call out their problem. They already know they got their problem. They want you to tell them there's a way out of the problem. Do you believe there is? Yes. If you're here today and you don't, come to the altar when we're done. Because we'll pray with you that your eyes will be open, that there's a way out. It's not just the songs that we sing. He says, this is serious business that we're involved in. Like, we can't be halfway about our faith. And you're going to come in contact with a lot of people over the holidays, and it could get a little intense around the Thanksgiving table if the topic of politics comes up, or many other topics. But he said, my mission is to send a purging fire on the earth. And again, I'm just going to say there's probably a lot of ways you could look at this, but the lens I'm looking through is that the body of believers has this fire on the inside of us because he baptized us with the Holy Spirit and fire. And instead of destroying people with the fire, we help remove the film that's around their life. It's a cleansing thing, the way you would try to kill a cancer cell with heat or a laser or an immune system. It's like we interact with people and we have an answer that they don't know, and there's something winsome and appealing about that, and they want to know what we have. That's how it's supposed to work. You have to build a relationship with them, and in the relationship, the fire will start to transact. Sometimes it's friction. I have one of those this week. It's okay. I wasn't apologizing for taking a stand for the truth of the word. And I didn't feel like I was, you know, it's a friend. We were just disagreeing about something. No problem. And not a member of our church or anything, but just, you know, we don't want to pour molasses over sin, right? Don't candy coat things. You just got to call it for what it is. It wasn't even that in this case, but inside of us, that fire is there to remind us, like, wait a minute, no, that even if it's 1 degree off of the truth of the word, be careful. Because if you don't say anything, they assume that you think it's okay. And you need a relationship before you can go deep with people. If they don't know you, they can't trust you. And they're not going to be vulnerable with you if they don't trust you. So I believe this is a really positive thing. When he said, my mission is to send a purging fire on the earth. In fact, I can hardly wait to see the smoke rising. Now, if you're looking through the judgmental lens, it's like he can't wait to start destroying people. Not what he's believing. If you ever wonder a scene in scripture that could help us to understand how he thinks about us, remember what he said to Peter before the rooster crows? Help me. You're going to deny me? After he just said, I'll die for you. And then over the fire, the rooster crows, and Jesus looks at Peter, who's sitting a distance away from him. Now, if you grew up with an angry God, you're thinking it's a glaring look at Peter at that moment. I don't believe that. I believe when Jesus looked at Peter, it was like, I told you this would happen, but I still got your back, brother. Because the flesh is weak. Spirit's willing, but the flesh is weak. And look at what happens to Peter. In the book of Acts, he's a completely different man. So courageous, he wouldn't be crucified upright, church history says, upside down. Because he didn't want to do it the same way Jesus. He was willing to give his life. It could have been partly because of that look. It wasn't condemning. This is just my imagination. If you don't like it, I'll give you your money back. Get a cup of coffee next week. No charge. I think when he says, in fact, I can hardly wait to see the smoke rising, it's when the people of the church catch this image to understand that together we can do much more than individuals alone, and we don't forsake the assembling together, because when we're together, there's fire. And that pulls off that veil off of the other people, and they don't know how to contend with the presence of the Lord. But when you're contending with it in a way that is comfortable to them, then they want what you have. Paul said, we can provoke people to jealousy. Like, they could see something in us that they would want by example, not just by our words. Hi, Dick. Good to see you. Hi, Sue. Dick and Sue Smith, he was one of our board members for many years, and we love you both more than I could ever even tell you, so glad you're here. Give him a hand. It's okay. You can do that. So I have a kind of baptism to go through, and I can't relax until my mission is accomplished. So he doesn't ask us to be a fire. He goes through the fire himself and is resurrected. And then he says this, which could also seem a little cranky. Do you think I've come with a nice little message of peace? No way. Believe me, my message will divide. It will divide a household of five into three against two or two against three. It will divide father against son and son against father, mother against daughter and daughter against mother. Well, how could this be a loving Jesus? Well, if you love somebody and you know they're headed down the wrong path, it's love to tell them that. And if you grew up in a certain culture, my parents did. You know, they went to a denominational church. My mother became born again, and my father was very hostile towards her. He had a bad temper in the beginning, and it took her 25 years of witnessing to him. And then he got saved. 25 years later, his tear came down. You know, the most old Italians are tough, but when that floodgate opens, man, then it just comes out. It was a beautiful thing to see, and she never gave up. And her brother, who was a pastor, said she had bulldog faith. When she locked on, she wasn't letting go. And she did not take that as an insult at all. So look, a lot of family practices that we might have that have been, we're accustomed to, might not line up with the word of God. So how do you speak the truth in love? You know, every person's going to have a different scenario, but we have to speak the truth in love, because we might be the only person that ever gets a chance to speak to them. And isn't that risky? Aren't we risking a relationship here? Yes, it is. I'm going to keep reading. You see a cloud arise from the sea in the west, and you say, here comes a shower. And you're right. Or you feel the hot wind blowing in from the desert in the south, and you say, it's going to be really hot. And you're right. So if you can look at the natural signs and you know what's going to happen, how come you can't look at the spiritual signs and know what's going to happen for a prodigal child or a wayward spouse or a million other scenarios here? We can if we want to. The hard part is, what do I do with what I know? And that's where saturating yourself in the Word, opening your heart to Holy Spirit, listening to worship music, all of the things that you can do proactively to get closer and closer to the Lord, to know His will, to block out the noise of the culture, something drops in your spirit and God will give you a plan and a strategy. And I know you both would be sitting next to each other, because Easter is the other half of our ministry team with Cindy. The two of them have been together in I don't know how many ministries. But how many times in ministry sessions you're plowing through and then all of a sudden, boom, just God opened your eyes to something. And it's not to condemn the person. It's to save you 9 million more meetings. The Holy Spirit will cut right to the chase. Now, whether the person reacts or not, that's not up to us. It's up to us to just speak it and let them know what we're sensing in the Lord. And both of you had discernment, but He amped it up because He knew that you wanted to dedicate your life to helping other people. Why wouldn't He come alongside us and do that? He does want to do that. So if you know this, if you know about the natural world, then He uses this word hypocrites, which doesn't sound like gentle Jesus, does it? I thought He loved everybody. He does. He loves them enough to tell them they're off on this one. You can predict the weather by paying attention to the sky. Why can't you interpret the urgency of this present moment? Now, let's just think about it as a culture. Is there an urgency in this present moment? I think so. I won't go there. If you don't know what I'm talking about, catch me after service. Why don't you see it for yourself? Sometimes a picture's worth 1,000 words. Maybe I'm not looking in the right place. The problem's up there, but I've got my head in the ground. I don't see a problem. Well, you're not looking in the right place. Do you see any problems? No, I don't see anything either. I got the same view as you. But 2 Timothy 1:6 and 7 says, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but power and love and a sound mind. And look, here's the deal. If our head is in the sand, if it's being driven by fear, wake up. Awakening. First song we sang, awakening. Awaken our church. Awaken your bride. Awaken your people. That's what we have to do. Because complaining about it, if you're not saying anything about it, is being hypocritical. And we have to be willing to do something about it. And I don't know if you remember when Cheyenne was here, but he broke down this word for fear, and he said it's kind of rare in the Bible. It's only used this one time in the New Testament, and it says cowardice. So it's not just fear like phobos is the other word that he used. It's a cowardice. And then he looked in Revelation. That was the other place where the word is used in Revelation. And it says that the cowards are going to be thrown into the fire. Right up with the murderers and everybody else. Like, what? So, listen, this is not meant to be a condemning message at all. But let's try to interpret the times. He clearly doesn't need us to be fully qualified by the world standards, right? Like, my God, there's so many scriptures in there. He chooses the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. Anybody in that club? Oh, yes, I'll be at the front of that line. So what do we do? Kind of flashback to last week. What do we do with the fear and cowardice? It goes in. Just picture this as a rumbling fire. You throw it in the fire. And then I love this because in the Old Testament, when the silversmith, right, they would be making these iron weapons. And it says, I have created the blacksmith who readies the fire and forges the weapons for war. Look at the person next to you and say, he is forging you as a weapon of war for the kingdom of God against the kingdom of darkness. Ho! Nobody else called you a weapon of war today. And I don't want to fight. I want to be Denmark. I want to be neutral. Can't, sorry, it's not an option on the list. Look, just get around Trisha. Boy, I'll tell you, she'll get you fired up. I've created the blacksmith who readies the fire and forges, thank you, Lord, that you forge us as weapons for war. And I know a lot of you know Isaiah 54 because it says, no weapon, no instrument forged against you will be allowed to hurt you. So as you're coming out of that fire, what happens? I get bravery. Think of Braveheart. I get more courage. And I'm walking in the glory with God, which Linnell, by the way, did an amazing job on Wednesday night talking about glory. Woo! And then we get right back to where we started, okay? So we're supposed to be his hands and feet on the earth. Fire's not a bad thing. It can kill people, but it can also heal people, right? Quarterize the wound. They need to be confronted with reality, not have maple syrup poured over all of the sin. Thank you, John. It's good to see you too, brother. Luke 12. Verse 1, Jesus said, guard yourselves from the yeast that puffs up the Pharisees. Hypocrisy, false appearance, trying to look better than you really are. Nothing is covered that won't be discovered. Nothing is hidden that won't be exposed. Whatever a person says in the dark will be published in the light of day. And whatever a person whispers in private rooms will be broadcast from the housetops. A lot of people don't know that's true. Doesn't mean he wants to shame you about this. He's trying to let you operate at the spiritual level, not the carnal level. Because can we just be honest for a minute? Like, sexual dysfunction is higher now than it's ever been in my lifetime. Okay, like even the television shows and the media and telling people in school, five-year-old kids, that there's no difference between a boy and a girl. Factually incorrect, by the way. There is a biological difference. So, like, why am I paying tax dollars for that curriculum? Because I don't sit on a school board to say stop. If I was really complaining, why don't I do something about it? This is the conversations I have with myself, as you can see. This is just true. But people don't know it. People don't know that a sexual encounter is a spiritual as well as a physical event. And you become one with that person, Paul says. And when you break apart, part of you leaves with that person. And that explains 98% of the country songs you'll ever hear. Because they're crying into their beer because their heart's broken. Because a part of their heart left. But it wasn't just country songs either. It was Diana Ross and the Supreme. Set me free, why don't you, babe? Just leave, get out of my life. But you just keep me hanging on. This could get dangerous, Nate. Keep going. So we had the amazing blessing. I know you remember Ed Silvoso, Cindy, because that was incredible time that when he came and spoke here. And he wrote this book called That None Should Perish. That's a quote from 1 Peter, I believe. And he's using prayer and evangelism and spiritual warfare as the concept. And this is part of what was wrecking me in front of the ShopRite yesterday, is because he was reminding me of the impact that we had in the community when we had that coffee shop open right there on the main thoroughfare. And this book was one of the reasons that gave me the vision to want to do that, because we didn't even have a church building at the time. We were just renting in the high school. But my office was right in downtown Bernardsville. I was on the Chamber of Commerce, and we just served people through this cafe. And a lot of what I got was from this book. And it says, the verse he uses right at the beginning is 2 Corinthians 4:3-4. It says, now, if our gospel remains veiled, it's only veiled from those who are lost and dying. See, the idea that sexual encounters is a spiritual as well as physical is absent from the thinking of the world. They don't want you to know that. They want you to think it's no big deal. And again, Cheyenne, I haven't followed up with him yet, but in California, they proposed a bill that would allow any child that gets born there, after 28 days of birth, you are not allowed to investigate what happened to the child. So even after the child's born, if the mother chooses to take the life of the child, can't be looked at. What else do we need, church? Like, how bad does it have to get? Never could have imagined this. And I don't have a great imagination, but could you have ever thought that that would be a law? Never mind, you're allowed to go into a store and steal up to $1,000 worth of goods and not get prosecuted. That was signed by somebody who's never owned a business. I'm going to calm down. Our gospel remains veiled because they're lost and dying, because the evil god of this age, Satan, has blinded the minds of unbelievers. So the fire of God is his church in the earth that goes out and shines light in dark places. It's never been darker. Sorry, it's just never been darker. So what are we waiting for? You can wait so long that you lose it. I'm not waiting. As a result, the light of the good news, the radiant glory, fire on the inside of you, radiant glory of the Lord in you, can't shine down on them. And many Christians feel like it's us against them. They're the enemy, the wicked, lost, that none should perish. God doesn't want one person to perish. He says in John 10:16, this is one of the verses that Ed Silvoso used in a book that I just got completely slammed by. In John 10:16 in the New King James, it says, other sheep I have which are not of this fold. And I found this quote online. It said, I cheered what I learned from Ed Silvoso, that the fold is not the flock. Pastors are called to pastor the city, not just the church. We saw this come to pass at the coffee shop. We were pastoring the city. They didn't know it, but we were impacting them. And you could probably be sitting there thinking, well, why did you close the store? I didn't want to close the store. Remember Easter? We were crying. We were crying when we had to close that store. It was right at the height of the financial crisis and a lot of reasons I won't get into now. We did not want to close that store. But again, yesterday, the Lord showed me I'm going to have another location right on 202 by the train station for free. It's like, woohoo! 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 you're called to pastor the city, not just the church. So if you get out of your car at the ShopRite and the guy is pushing the carts, like, does God care about him? Is that who you want to be? When you were asked as a kid, what do you want to be when you grow up? Oh, I want to be that guy. You think he wanted to be that guy? Is he less than you? No. That doesn't come natural to us. If we're not in the Spirit, we look down at other people because we feel better about ourselves because they're worse off than we are. That's not Jesus. He says in John 15, 16, in the voice, I will give my life for the sheep. There are many more sheep than you can see here, and I will bring them as well. They will hear my voice, and the flock will be united. One flock, one shepherd. Man, I love that language. If you're not ashamed to identify with me before others, Luke 12, 8 says, the Son of Man, Jesus is talking, will affirm you before God and all the heavenly messengers. But if you deny me before others, you will be denied before God and all the heavenly messengers. I've been in meetings where people that say they're in full-time ministry are denying their Christianity. And it's not my job to call them out. I didn't have authority. It was if they were a leader in this church, then I would call it out because I have authority. I didn't have authority, but it opened up a whole chasm in my mind, like, oh my God, they're not who I thought they were. They're ashamed of the gospel. And Paul says in Romans, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. It's the power of God unto salvation to anyone who would believe it. Huh. Let's talk more about him. Don't worry how you'll respond. See, this is a jump ahead. I skip verse 10 to save a little time. But he's like, if you're in that situation and you don't know what to say, don't worry about what you should say. The Holy Spirit in that very moment will give you the words to say at the moment that you need those words. We've seen that in the counseling ministry here. Exodus 20 verse 7 says, you are not to use my name for your own idle purposes, for the eternal God will punish anyone who treats his name as anything less than sacred. When are you going to get to the good news, Pastor? I'm trying. But the point here is if you say you're a Christian and you're living a compromised life, that's using the name of the Lord in vain. You got to contend with the book. And you got to be willing to do what the book says. You're going to buy the pearl, you got to buy the field. Right? No discount. Give it up for him and watch what he does. Amazing. Couldn't predict it. I'm just skip through that for time's sake. And what about this idea that Christians shouldn't be political? Well, I was thinking about it, and right on the cross, it said, Jesus, the King of the Jews. You're sitting in a church called King of Kings. Is that political? That's his name. Revelation 19, 16, it's written on the side. King of Kings, Lord of Lords. How is it not political? Well, it's not necessarily the natural political realm, but it's the spiritual realm. But he's got to be Lord over my life before I can help him be Lord over somebody else's life. And then the political takes care of itself because you got Christians in charge and the righteous are in authority. So the people rejoice. And we just bought a lie. I'm sorry. I think we just bought a lie as the overall church that he's coming back any day. It's so bad now. He's got to be coming back. This must be the end times. So why bother voting? Just can you cancel that way of thinking, please? Occupy until he comes. We don't know when he's coming back. We don't have a date. I'm going to be busy about my Father's business. Did somebody feed you, Lord? No, my food is to do the will of the one who sent me. I know what my mission is. That's all Jesus quotes, right? So I don't know. And then you look at the charge against Paul. These people are political agitators. They're turning the world upside down. They're saying that Jesus is king, not Caesar. Yes, we are. Yes, we are. Whoever the president is, that's not the final king. The final king is Jesus, King of Kings. Foot washer. That's upside down in the world's eyes. And then they say about Paul, we found this man misleading our nation and forbidding us to give tribute to Caesar and saying that he himself, I'm sorry, that was about Jesus, my bad. Christ, a king. Jesus is Christ, a king. So, I don't know, let's just lose that idea that politics is disengaged from the church. At the local level, we could all be involved somewhere, sitting on some council, learning about the election, finding out what the people's voting record is, and saying, no, I don't agree with that. And even be willing to run for an office. The former director here, Joel Davis, is now on the school board in Hillsborough. That's awesome. I helped him. I tried to help him any way I could to get, I mean, because that's what you want. You want godly people in authority that fear the Lord. So this is a book by Mario Murillo. I hope to get him back someday. Believe me when I tell you, love him. And you don't, you probably can't see it. It's so, it's too small, but the subtitle, it says, don't leave quietly. And then the subtitle is a call for everyday people to rise up and defeat evil. All right, that's all of us. We're just everyday people. And if we don't rise up, then the only thing necessary for evil to prevail is for good people to do nothing. Right? So we're all called to be a light in the midst of the darkness. Not a judge, not angry, not taking up physical weapons against other people, but knowing the truth of the word and conveying that in the way we live. So I say start with voting. My father was a veteran, World War II. Anybody else have relatives that are veterans? He knew lots of people that died. They were willing to die to protect our freedom. And we're not even willing to vote. And the numbers are horrible for this last midterm election. The amount of Christians that voted was way too low. What's up with that? How, that's a spirit of stupor. That it's all just going to be fine. Stupid is a different spirit. This is stupor with an R. I don't want to use the S word in church. It's actually called sedition, trying to overthrow the government, but it's the government of every person's heart. It's not taking arms against the people in office. Any action, especially speech or writing, promoting discontent or rebellion. In Acts 24, it says about Paul, I'm going to read it here, this man is a plague. That's what they said about Paul. A creator of dissension among all the Jews throughout the world, a ringleader of the sect of the Nazarenes. I hope somebody calls me a ringleader someday. That would be awesome. He's one of those Jesus freak ringleaders. Sign me up for that job. I'm going to skip ahead a little bit too. I could talk about that next week. I'm going to finish here. Thank you, Nate. I don't have to pay him much to do that either. It's really nice. The Lord is not slow about enacting his promise. He's not slow, but patient and merciful to you. Thank him for that one. He's not slow about enacting his promise. He's patient and merciful to you, not wanting one to perish. This is the verse that the book was written about, 2 Peter 3. Sorry. Not wanting one person to perish, but wanting everyone to turn away from following his own path and to turn towards God's path. The day of the Lord will come unexpectedly like a thief in the night, and on that day, the sky will vanish with a roar. Now, you might have to just open your spirit up a little bit here right now, because a lot of people that read this verse in the King James or the New King James read it as a destruction of the planet, of Earth, because that's how some translations interpret it. Now, you know, you don't have to believe me when I tell you, I really dug into this because I don't want to get up here and say something if I haven't done my homework. So I hope you do believe me. But there are many scholars that think that burning it and destroying it is not the nuanced meaning that Peter was talking about here, okay? So that's my little caveat. Will unexpectedly come like a thief in the night, and on that day, the sky will vanish with a roar, the elements will melt with an intense heat, and the earth and all the works done in it will be seen as they truly are. That's a very different picture than destroying the whole place. No, it's talking about a fire that comes and pulls the cloak off. Think of it like cellophane. Once sin came in the garden, it was like the earth got wrapped in this darkness of sin, and the fire's gonna burn it off. Oh, that's a very different story. To reveal the whole truth that was supposed to be there all along. Ha, that's good news. Because the new Jerusalem is coming down out of heaven to earth. That's his final return. So why wouldn't we be trying to do this while we're here modeling what's gonna happen for eternity? And another thing I'll just tell you, you know, when we talk about Passover, when we talk about the resurrection, like, we don't have enough excitement about what it's going to be like on the other side. We've really been sold another bill of goods on that whole thing, that we are going to be ruling and reigning with him forever. We're going to have resurrected bodies like he did when he came back. We're not nearly as excited as we should be about that. And this is part of it, like, because in 1 Corinthians 15:58, he says, "Therefore, my brethren, be steadfast and immovable, always abounding in the things of the Lord, knowing this, Charlie Cassisi, that your labor in the Lord is not in vain." What does that mean? Oh, well, you know, you're rearranging the chairs on the Titanic. It's sinking, but at least you're doing something nice for someone. Oh, I don't want to serve that God. No, he's saying what you're learning here is going to put you in good stead for eternity. You are training for reigning forever. That one person that I'm quoting now said, "Your best day on this earth is just a shadow of what your life is going to be like on the other side." That helped me a whole lot, especially as gravity keeps trying to take over my life here. Gravity does not win in the end. Jesus wins in the end. Knowing that one day all this will come to pass. Think of what sort of people you ought to be. We should be pretty happy, right? That's what Mario Morello says. Like, the guy said, you know, "How you doing today?" And he said, "Oh, under the circumstances, I'm doing okay." And he's like, "What are you doing under there? You're not under the circumstances. You're saved, right? You're going to heaven when you die, right?" Like, it should be pretty, I know that could be like a little one-liner, but pretty good thought. What sort of people ought we to be? How should you be living faithful and godly lives, waiting hopefully and hastening the coming of God's day? Come on, let's stand. Just lift our hands for a minute and just say, "Lord, I'm waiting hopefully for the coming of your day. I'm going to be about my Father's business. I'm not going to be slack. I'm not going to wait for my own things to happen. I'm going to be about your business here in the earth, because that's where the blessing comes, when we're obedient. The blessing comes in obedience. And rebellion, you said, is as a sin of witchcraft. So, Lord, sober our minds today to recognize this amazing gift that you have given to us." And just think of these words. Knowing that one day all this great stuff is going to come to pass. Think about what sort of people you ought to be. How you should be living faithful and godly lives, waiting hopefully for the hastening, coming, the day of the Lord. And I repeated that. "When the heavens will vanish in flames, the elements will melt away with intense heat. What will happen next, and what we hope for, is what God promised, a new heaven and a new earth where justice reigns." That's good news. That's good news. And no temporary offer from the devil to live a safer life is going to compete with the resurrection power of Jesus. So, Lord, awaken us like we sang today. Awaken your bride. Awaken your church, that we would not be a slumbering, slothful people. Huh, that spirit of stupor where it's like we're drunk. Wake us up to the urgency of the moment that we're living in here today. And we want to do what you want us to do, not some man's plan, but we can hear from you ourselves. Just put your hand on your head, top of your head, and say, "Open heaven over my life so that I can clearly hear and obey what you want me to do. Better is one day in your courts than 1,000 elsewhere." Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hearing from God is the best prayer you could ever ask. Just, "Lord, I want to clearly hear your voice." Maybe you don't know the Lord. You could be here visiting, out of town, home for the holidays. The people that are excited that are around you, they're Christians. And at one time, somebody offered them a prayer, and they said, "Would you like to invite Jesus to be the Lord of your life?" And most of us were like, "Well, I got nothing to lose. I might as well try that. I tried everything else." Because our lives are pretty messed up. Can I get an amen? Amen. 40 years ago, I should have been dead. Really, I'm not making this up. I'm not exaggerating. I wish I was. But that's just how broken I was. So for 40 years, he's allowed me to do his work. That's amazing. And he would allow you to do his work too, but you just got to open your heart to him first. It's a relationship. And that's all. It's not church. It's not religion. It's not some ritual thing that we do. It's just learning that he really is a loving father. And many of us might not have seen that in the natural, but let's just say a prayer together. If that's you or you're watching online, just invite Jesus into your life. Say, Heavenly Father, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I recognize my life is not all it could be or should be because I haven't made you a priority in my life. But I heard today that I can make you a priority by inviting you in. I ask you to forgive me of the sins that kept me far away from you. I ask you to fill me with your spirit and open my eyes to the truth of your word. I want to turn away from sin. And I want to turn towards a loving father who will adopt me into his family. Lord, I accept you as my Lord and Savior today. No strings attached. In Jesus' name. Amen. Doesn't have to be a complicated thing. Doesn't have to be a complicated thing. But I'll tell you what. If you said that prayer, the enemy is really not happy right now. Okay? Because he doesn't want to lose another prisoner from the jail cell. So take an act. Take a step of faith and say, I'm going up to that altar right now because I'm going to abandon that old life, reckless abandonment, and I'm going up to that altar. And devil, you can't have me. I'm out. You're done messing my life up. I'm going with Jesus.